got to the main part now. This is the sister that's going to drop the knowledge on us tonight. Okay, brothers and sisters. And I'm happy to say, brothers and sisters, that can we please make some noise for our keynote speaker now, our sister, Dr. Elaine Ferguson. Brothers and sisters, first time on the platform. Sister, how are you doing, my queen?
Oh, my divine brother, I am so happy to be here. Thank you, thank you, thank you for inviting me to share some words of insight and wisdom with my family on the other side of the pond. Before I begin, I want to thank you again from the bottom of my heart for inviting me to be here. But most importantly, I want to thank you for being who you are and the beautiful work that you're doing and across the world. I am so honored and I'm so moved. Every time I watch the program, I'm just moved by everything that I feel and see. And I just want to say I need a moment, but I don't. You know, it's just so beautifully overwhelming. I'm overwhelmed by the last story about the children of our Native brothers and sisters in Canada. That was a concentration camp. I don't care what they called it. Those were concentration camps. Come on, let's be honest. With the intention of destroying those children under the guise of educating them and acculturating them. But before I begin, I want to acknowledge Sister Sasha Johnson. I just want to ask that we take another moment, because this came on my heart as I was listening to her story again. I'd like for us to take a collective moment and see the sister healthy, returning to her life in all of its glory, and sending her the love that she has given, as well as the love that we feel for her in this moment, because love is the greatest healer. So let's do that first before I begin. Thank you. I want to add a couple more things before I begin. Yes,
time,
I am.
Take your time. Take your time.
Thank you. I'm in. My life has been in the Midwest, in Chicago, in the U.S. However, I live about 20 minutes from the home of the Jackson Five. So I just had to do a shout out for Gary and Deanna. Whenever I have relatives who visit or friends, they want me to take them to 2300 Jackson Street, which I do, which is the home. Their first home is a little cottage, but it's still there and people from around the world still visit. So I just wanted to acknowledge that. The brothers who spoke before me, I am overwhelmed by your, by the beauty of your spirit, by your commitment to this, to the upliftment of our people, by your scholarship. Oh my God, I'm just blown away. I can't talk, but I will, because it's so overwhelming for me. I learned so much. I also want to share one thing about the history makers. There is a website in the US called thehistorymakers.org, and it is a collective of interviews, video interviews with people of high esteem across a wide swath of the African-American community. I would suggest connecting with them because they have great resources and know how to do exactly what you're doing. That's what I would recommend. So brother, I'm ready to begin. Would you
put
the slides up? Did you receive the second slide set that I sent?
Oh no, sister, sorry.
Yes, I sent an edited because I didn't need to condense them. So if you could pull that up, I'll just talk a little bit about myself.
Yes, give me some time. Yes, sister.
While you pull it up, I am a native of Detroit, Michigan. I always speak in honor of my parents because it's the work that they did that allowed my sister and I to achieve our goals. So that's why I'm so happy to hear about your school and the work that you're doing for our children, because it begins in the womb. It begins at the moment, our education begins at the moment of conception. And my parents always told my sister and I that there wasn't anything we couldn't do. So I believed them. I made the mistake of believing that. So I decided at a very young age, when I was 10, that I wanted to become a physician. and here I am today. And it was not an easy task, but I always had my parents' support. They always encouraged me. My mother wasn't having it when I was having a hard time in medical school. I would call her up moaning and groaning. She's like, I'm not hearing it. You're getting through. It's not that bad. And really, relatively speaking, she was correct. It was difficult for me at the time, as medical school is very difficult. But as I grew, I understood what my mother was saying to me, because when I put my life in context of that which my ancestors had survived, I was a piece of cake, relatively speaking. So I have practiced holistic medicine for over three decades in the Chicago area, primarily because when I was in medical school, even though I didn't learn about health and I didn't learn how to help people stay healthy, we learned about disease, treatments, diagnosis, medication, surgery, radiation, et cetera. I became in awe of the human body in terms of what I learned. It is such a magnificent creation. And I'll talk about that a little bit more. It is not a machine. It is a dynamic organism. It is really a temple that the divine created for us to inhabit as spiritual beings. I have seen miracles happen with patients that my professors could not explain or share with us how it happened in terms of the understanding that they have from a reductionistic mechanical point of view. But miracles do happen. Miracles happen day in and day out in terms of patients overcoming life-endangering diseases without explanation. That's how the spirit works. And we'll get into that a little bit more further and later when I share some more with you about what super healing is. So over the last 3 years, I have begun to shift my focus from the bigger picture of health and well-being to helping my people, African-Americans in particular, but Africans around the world in general, to deal with these wounds of racism and how racism has impacted us.
Sister Doctor, just let you know that it's ready when you're ready, dear.
Okay, well, let's go.
All right.
Then. Let's begin. Thank you.
No worries, Queen. Brothers and sisters, once again, make some noise for our Queen, our main speaker, our sister. Pure love to our Queen here today. Okay, this should be it now.
Okay, thank you. Next slide, please. I've already introduced myself, so we can move to the next slide. I asked this question in the context of what we have lived through the last year, since the beginning of COVID in particular, as well as the issues and the events that happened around the deaths of our brothers and sisters. So the question is, particularly as it has related to us on this side of the pond, brother, I think it's moving to on its own.
I didn't touch anything.
Microsoft has had a mind of its own with me today, so that's why I had to send it to you. So again, the question is, what's changed since the outpouring across the world of support for the Black Lives Matter movement in general and the deaths of our brothers and sisters, George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, and others? What has significantly changed in your life in the last year? I just want you to think about it. Next slide. And I'm speaking specifically regarding how has racism changed in your life, in your experiences of it? Next slide, please.
Can I just add, Sister Doctor?
Absolutely.
If there's any questions that you have for our beautiful Queen, if there's any questions, brothers and sisters, please use the Q&A box, and Sister Jurita will be reading out any questions. So please, as you're going through this presentation, if there's questions that come to your mind, please put it in the Q&A box. Thank you very much, Elaine.
Thank you. Or, as we've discussed in some regards already today, nothing's really changed, and we still have significant concerns about how racism is impacting our lives. the vitriolic racism with the departure of the 45th president in the United States hasn't really changed. While the imagery and the new president certainly is in place, nothing's really changed as far as I'm concerned on the ground. And we haven't had meaningful change in terms of the outpouring. What has changed in terms of the consciousness of racism, in terms of the systematic structures of racism, and the deaths of our brothers and sisters in the United States in particular? I know it's happening in the UK. I really had to hold myself when I saw that beautiful child being drugged. Oh, I can't even talk about it being, because this is the trauma that we experience when we see these things happen to our people. Next slide, please. So we are still feeling the pain of 2020 and the cumulative pain of 402 years of our oppression. Next slide. So let's explore together how to stop your suffering now. So today I'm going to share with you, I think you have to click a button. The truth about racism.
It's moving by itself right now.
Thank you, you're a great assistant. The fundamental truths about racism. Next, how racism damages your physical and mental health. Next, please. And how to start healing your invisible wounds. There's a myth that we believe that racism has to end before we can heal or stop feeling the pain. That is not true. And I'll share with you why it's not true. Next slide, please. So I'm going to lay the foundation first. Next slide, please. So let's talk about health. How do you think about your health? Most of us think that health is the absence of disease. Health is much more than that. It's not merely the absence of physical or psychological disease. Health is a dynamic process. It's ongoing. It's always evolving. It's always unfolding. And it represents a harmonic symphony of our biochemical, physiological, and psychological interactions, and I might add spiritual as well, that occur within our dynamic, highly specialized anatomy, within our mind, within our body, and within and our spirit as it interfaces with our environment. Next, please. This is a continuum of illness and wellness, the middle being the neutral point where you don't necessarily experience disease or healthy, just basically neutral. And that to the far right is high level wellness, or what I call super healing, optimal health and well-being. And to the left are the disease phases. Next. This is a diagram of optimal health and wellness and the factors that play a part. Next. And these are the 12 dimensions of wellness. I hope you can see this kind of blurry. I apologize for that. But it speaks to the fact that health is just not physical. Next. I want to talk to you about your amazing body that I hinted to. This, for me, is where the rubber meets the road. And I want to ask you a question. When you think of your body, what do you think? And not only what do you think about your body, but how do you talk to your body? What Woo! Do you say to yourself?
Come on.
Thank you. Most of our talk is very negative. We don't appreciate our bodies. We talk down to it. We talk about what's not functioning right. What's wrong with it? I'm getting OLD, which is a term I don't use, or I'm ugly, or I'm this or that, or look at that flab, or look. We don't really honor the truth that we are such amazing creations, and that we have an amazing body that is capable, even in the midst of these experiences that we have as African people around the world, we are still capable of creating optimal health and well-being when we do the right things, when we give our body, our mind, and our spirit the ingredients that it needs to function optimally. It is possible. Next.
And can I just say, sister, I have to say this, and I don't want to embarrass you, sister. One of the main reasons why I wanted you on this platform teaching what you're teaching now, because this is, to me, fantastic, is not just the information. I'm loving your spirit, sister, and your humility. So I'm saying it's already coming across, my queen. Just keep teaching.
Well, thank you so much. So I want to share, and I'm talking quickly because you know how much I want to share, but do not think that my rapid response dishonors what you said. I totally receive and you appreciate teach, your sharing. Thank you so much. So I want to talk to you briefly about my work, specifically in this world of wellness and holistic medicine. Long story short, I have been frustrated to a certain degree in the world of holistic medicine because patients come to me to be fixed. They don't understand because no one's ever taught them the role we play in the development of diseases, but they come looking for a fix. And oftentimes they come with severe illnesses and I'm their Obi-Wan Kenobi, I'm their last hope. One of the things that's come to me, a principle that I had been articulating, but not fully over the course of my career, and it came to me in its totality in 2013, is the term superhealing. It was given to me. And superhealing, could you go on to the next slide, please? It is the means of, you can go on to the next one. That's even better so they can see it better. It acknowledges fundamentally that we have an amazing body, a magnificent mind, and an indomitable eternal spirit that's designed to function optimally and to produce vibrant health and well-being. This is your natural state of being, one that functions with ease, and that's where the term dis-ease comes from. When we function out of ease, we create the conditions that lead to the development of diseases or chronic health conditions. Next, please. A superhealing approach emphasizes the importance and the necessity of involving the whole person, all aspects of being, in the creation of optimal health and wellness. Next. Superhealing again occurs when we are consciously engaging the mind, body, and spirit together in order to more fully utilize our body's powerful internal repair and regeneration mechanisms. That's natural. That's what happens. That's how we're designed divinely to function, to heal and repair ourselves. We don't have to fix it ourselves. We just have to give it the space, that intelligence, the space to function optimally. Next. One of the topics that I talk about, which you go back, thank you, that's very important to understand, which speaks to this reductionistic, mechanistic approach. You are not your DNA. Your body is not controlled by your DNA, despite what you've been told. You've been told that you can inherit diseases based on your family history. That's not true for chronic illnesses. It's true for a very small range of genetic diseases. But we know now in terms of the field of epigenetics that how you live, how we live, determines our health more than any other factor. So if you live like your family members who developed those diseases, high blood pressure, diabetes, heart disease, cancer, et cetera, you will be at greater risk for developing them. But if you don't, you won't develop them. Both of my grandfathers had diabetes. I'm not getting it because I live quite differently. My parents had cancer. I'm not getting cancer either because I live quite differently. The other important notion is your mind is not separate from your body. Your mind and your body are one, as well as your spirit. And your emotions aren't stuck in your head. They are located throughout your body. That's why you feel something within your body when you become emotionally upset. And your spirit is not a biochemical reaction in your brain or your notions of it, as Western science would have you believe. It is not a figment of your imagination. It is the truth of who you are. Next slide, please.
Wow, sister, can I just say that, you know, you're a different type of doctor, sister. You are a different type of doctor because you've turned it upside down right now. You've turned it upside down. And Sister Kemet has already stated on there, she says that doctor, she's so lovely, so humble, so pure. We love her. So you're really taking us, sister. You're really taking us.
Oh, this is the work that I am here to do. And if you only knew how much I love you all, you would You would, I hope you feel it, because this is why I'm here, because of the love I have for my people that my parents instilled in me, that I have had the pleasure and honor of expressing. Thank you. So I want to share with you the five pillars of super healing. That's really the culmination of the work that's in my book and everything that I do, because these are the foundations of creating good health. The first is to have an unwavering determination to set an intention. The second is to detoxify, to remove those toxins, not only physical and environmental, but psychological and spiritual toxins, such as our false self-identity of dehumanizing us, that we're not human, those types of things. Number three is to nourish ourselves and replenish both physically, psychologically, and spiritually. Number four is truly the most important aspect of super healing, of health and well-being, because we can improve our health by doing the right things, but until we love and accept ourselves, we will not experience optimal health and well-being. And the fifth is to evolve and refine a health enhancement plan and program to take those four elements and to create a meaningful, personalized program that you live by and that you develop to improve your health and well-being. Next, please. Next, we can move on, because I think I've already said that. I love what Deepak Chopra is, one of my mentors, yes, from a distance, and absolutely, this is the truth. The way you think, the way you behave, and the way you eat can influence your life by 30 to 50 years. Either way, it can add 30 to 50 years, or it can take away 30 to 50 years. Because stress, and we're going to get into that, plays a tremendous part in terms of the development of diseases. I just sent, and I'll share this, I'm happy to share this, I just sent to my friends a grandfather in Kenya who just celebrated his 137th birthday. And he's talking on his cell phone, okay? He's alive and well, he's not in the bed, he's moved around, he might look like he's maybe 90, but we don't know the lifespan. We don't know how long the human body is designed to live, because we haven't figured it out. It's really designed to live indefinitely. And if you think 137 years is good, there's a grandmother in Nigeria on the other side of the continent who's 190 years young. So this is what's possible for us when we live in accordance to how we were designed to live. Next slide, please.
So did you say 190?
Yes, sir, 190. She could be his grandmother. So disease, as I mentioned, is an imbalance manifestation. It's a reflection of our internal alarm system telling us something's wrong. I often say the body whispers, stop doing that. I need a break. It speaks, you know you're tired, don't go to work today. It yells, I told you to stop, take a vacation or go on sick leave. And then if we don't listen, it visits us with a dis-ease. Pain is a gift, because if we didn't feel pain, we wouldn't know something was out of order within our body. Those who don't have pain receptors do great harm to themselves. They damage their bodies, they break bones because they don't have a feedback mechanism. While those of us who have the gift of feeling pain and experiencing pain, we don't like it because we don't honor and recognize it. And I've learned over the years to honor my pain. When I feel pain, I stop and I acknowledge it. I speak to, I say, yes, thank you. If it's a part of my body that I can reach is hurting, I'll touch it and say, thank you. And I've learned that the pain resolves faster when I give it acknowledgement. When I fight it and resist, as the Borg said, resistance is futile, it just makes it worse because we're not honoring it. And the Chinese term for crisis and opportunity are one and the same. So think about our experience in the terms of not only the crises and the depth and breadth of our experiences as African people, but think about it as an opportunity, which is not to say we deserve to experience it, but think about the possibilities that in terms of how we can rise above and how we have risen above, how our ancestors have risen above the crises and the experiences of so-called white supremacy and racism. Next, please. So, as I mentioned, we are not a machine. You are not a biological machine. Your brain is not a computer. Don't think in those terms, because when we think in those terms, you're telling your body to function and your brain to function in a way that is not normal. It's more like an ocean or a garden. It's dynamic. It has so many different components to it. And you don't have to know about all of them, but just the fact that they exist. And when you love and honor and appreciate yourself and your body and your mind and your spirit, those dynamic aspects of your body and of your mind and of your spirit will honor you and support you even better. Next slide, please. This is one of my favorite diagrams because it speaks to the truth. No, I know we don't look like this, but it speaks to the infinite capacity of being that we have because we are eternal beings. And there's no beginning of the spirit, there's no beginning of the body, and there's no end to the mind. They all are dynamic elements and aspects of the same thing of the spirit. Next, please. This is what Jung said, and it's true, it's artificial. These separations that occurred in Western science are just made up, as is the separation from spirit. They just made it up. And it was basically a deal with the Catholic Church. The church got the spirit, the scientists got the body, and that's how it happened back in the days of Descartes. Next slide, please. Let's briefly talk about the mind. Next slide, please. Your mind is the element that enables us to be aware of our existence in this realm. It is not just that we think, our consciousness is actually the foundation of the mind and allows it to function. Next slide, please. Again, we have been led to believe that the mind exists only in the brain. It exists throughout the entire body and beyond. There have been studies, and I talk about this in Super Healing, where I'll just share this very briefly because I think it illustrates the point. The Army in the United States conducted a study where it took a scraping of white blood cells from inside the cheek of several men and service women. And it separated them and took it to a lab down the hall, and it showed the men and women very violent movies, and measurable changes occurred within the cells that were separated as the persons were shown the movies appropriately at the times where there were great distress. These white blood cells separated 50 feet from the body, from the persons, showed changes, and they kept moving it further and further away, and they stopped at 50 miles, they were still connected. So the mind, we have no understanding as to where our minds begin and end, because the mind is an infinite aspect of the spirit. Next slide, please. Let's skip over this slide because we're gonna go into stress pretty quickly. Here we are at stress. So we talk about stress in Super Healing because it is a critical aspect as to our life experience of distress and how our health is impacted by our distress. And it is not appreciated fully in Western medicine. The vast majority of doctor visits in the United States, I believe is 90% at the last count, were stress related. And when we do address stress, it's medicating it. We rarely give our patients the full range of resources that can help them to better manage the stress responses causing their diseases, because stress leads to inflammation, which is a pillar of disease. Next slide, please. This is just a schemata of how stress impacts different aspects of the brain as well as the body in terms of releasing hormones. It's a cascade of responses, and that's why it's not just in your head. It happens throughout your entire body as these stress hormones are released. Next slide, please. I just want to talk about this very quickly, the stress response. If you see the part of the brain that's highlighted, it's in the mid part of the brain. And it triggers, in general, and the amygdala, which is the emotional system center in the brain. When we are triggered chronically with stress, it prevents the prefrontal cortex, which is our thinking brain. Some call it the executive, some call it the God brain. It blocks our pathway. So we can't even get to where we really should be in terms of responding to stress because we're stuck in our emotions. And that's where our trauma resides. And that's where our knee-jerk responses happen. We don't give we the chance to respond more fully and appropriately as conscious human beings is blocked by the severe distress response that we constantly release. And that's what happens to us in particular when we have experiences of racism. Next slide, please. And these are some of the biological changes that happen. It changes everything. It changes the way we breathe, it changes the way we think, the way our stomach functions and intestinal tract, our muscles get tight because we're preparing to either run away from the danger or to fight it. That's how we were designed. And it's a beautiful system for acute danger. That's how the divine created it, created us. But when we constantly experience these stress hormones and releasing them, it leads to our weakening of a variety of systems, in particular our immune system, as well as our cognitive functioning. And that's what triggers our increased likelihood of developing disease. Next, please. And this is just a quick schemata of what happens with the stress response, as I've already mentioned. Next, please. So let's get into the real meat of our gathering today. And I want to talk about what is racism from a medical perspective, a psychological perspective. And I just want you to know I intentionally made it a lowercase r because I want to reduce its power in your mind. I want you to begin to think of it differently. Next slide, please. So racism, as you all probably know, but I'll review this quickly, is a system of exploitative ethnic hate and domination in all of its blatant and subtle forms in various diluted terms. Prejudice, discrimination, unconscious bias, microaggressions, and insults, et cetera, combined with the ability to inflict harm and control through physical force and psychological coercion over the targeted persons and groups. Next slide, please. It includes psychological, physical, emotional, and spiritual dimensions that visits harms upon all involved, both the target, the survivor or the thriver, and the agent, the perpetrator or maintainer of his existence. Now, yes, while I agree with the vast majority of what the brother shared before me about the smartness and the aspects of racism from the physical dynamic, we know truly that, just look at our president number 45, former president, racists aren't happy because they are out of order with themselves. Next slide, please. From my perspective, racism is also an aspect of the larger disconnected self-identity and personality structure of disinformation, domination, destruction, dehumanization, and death that includes all forms of exploitative and violent behavior, such as environmental harm and destruction, local, national, and international. Talk about climate change and why it has happened, sexism, economic exploitation, classism, ethnic and religious domination. Next slide, please. And is fueled by a false sense of personality based on physical obsession and deification of skin, gender, ethnic, and class-based so-called superiority. It is accompanied by a misguided notion of superiority, irrational entitlement, and violent control. Dr. Bobby Wright called it the psychopathic racial personality. Racism consciously and intentionally attempts to deny our essential reality and spiritual awareness, our connection to the internal divine. In other words, to our soul and spirit and to all of life. This to me is where the rubber really meets the road. Yes, we are targeted because of our skin and because of our physical characteristics. But for me, when the Europeans went around the world and invaded the different parts of the world, the first thing they did was to bring the religion that separated our ancestors and all other people around the world from their true spiritual connectivity. And it told them the lie that they were less than human. And that was the greatest assault, because when you know who you are as the divine beings that we are, nothing can change. Nothing can control you. They can only destroy your physical form. Next slide, please. Racism is a pervasive and inescapable, unavoidable fact of life for all of us. Next slide, next please. It takes a dangerous and deadly toll in many ways. The police murders and hate crimes against us are merely the tip of the tip of the iceberg. And I share with people that we get, and I understand why we respond as we do, but there's a much larger picture in terms of how it impacts our health and well-being. Next slide, please. Yes, and it does wreak havoc on our physical health. So with this expanded definition in mind, racism is the most harmful, toxic, life-endangering stressor that all African-Americans and all African people in the diaspora, sorry, I didn't update that slide for my brothers and sisters on the other side of the pond, past and present, experience throughout our lives from the womb, from the moment of conception to the tomb. Next slide, please.
So, sister, I don't want to pre-estimate what you're going to go into, but would you agree at the beginning with Leon asked the question, what is the number one problem? Is it racism as you're defining it today?
I have a little different opinion. Okay. While physically I would say yes, racism is the number one problem, but the real problem is our internalized response to it.
Wow.
Because we have the capacity to choose differently. Well, go back to Dr. David Williams, please. Yes, thank you. This is the perfect moment. And could you turn on the video, my brother? This is Dr. Yes, David Williams, who is one of my beloved mentors. Again, I discovered him about his work about 3 years ago. He is a brother from Trinidad, and he came to the U.S. for his education and became a sociologist and wanted to research the impact racism has on our health. And of course, he was told by his mentors, can't measure, it's too complex, it's too many factors. Not true. So please play. This is a 60 Minutes interview that was aired about in April of this year. So please play it, my brother.
Imagine a fully loaded jumbo jet with 220 passengers and crew taking off and crashing today. And the same thing happened every day next week and every day next month and every day for the rest of the year. That's exactly what is occurring when we say there are racial disparities in health in the United States. Over 200 black people dying prematurely every single day.
Dr. David Williams, who is originally from the Caribbean island of St. Lucia, is a professor of public health at Harvard and chairman of its Department of Social and Behavioral Sciences. He has spent a quarter century researching the corrosive impact that racism has on the health of people of color all around the world.
You have conducted rigorous psychological, sociological, scientific studies of this phenomenon.
That's correct. We've done studies in South Africa, their colleagues doing studies in Australia, studies in the UK, studies across the world, and we find in all of these contexts, empirically, statistically, that experiences of discrimination are directly impacting health.
Can something as complex and subjective as racial discrimination...
My brother, you can stop. Thank you. That is where the rubber meets the road for us. My brother, can you pull back up the slides? Thank you. Next slide, please. I want you to think about this for the United States. I couldn't find statistics for the UK, I apologize. But if what he says is true, which we know it is, 200 black people die prematurely due to their experiences of racism every day. That's 1,400 excess premature deaths a week, 6,000 extra deaths a month. and 72,800 unnecessary deaths each year. And it's not just one year, it's every year. And this probably, this number is probably underestimated, quite honestly. Next slide, please. Racism is the true silent killer. So what are we going to do about it? Next slide, please. My hero, Nelson Mandela, said racism must be consciously combated and not discreetly tolerated. Yes, this is the key. Yes, I want to show you, go ahead, brother. Next slide. I want to show you a powerful example of how thought affects us. For those of you who haven't heard of him, Dr. Masaru Emoto, he was a Japanese, very innovative, open, spiritually based scientist. And he wanted to show the power of thought. And he took water and devised a technique to freeze water that had been come from either polluted places or had been treated with negative words or positive words. So this is a picture, the one on the left is a picture of water from a polluted lake. And the picture to the right is the same water after it had been prayed for and blessed with love. Do you see the difference? This is the power of thought captured. Next slide, please. And these are some other examples of the power of thought. If you look at the top row, these are all toxic thoughts or toxic polluted thoughts. One is heavy metal music, the other is you make me sick, and the other is Adolf Hitler, okay? And if you look at the lower ones, these beautiful crystals are words of spirit, of words of love, blessings, Mother Teresa, love and appreciation, thank you. See the difference. And this is what happens when we think differently. And if you remember, I began with how do you talk to yourself, because it's so important what you say to your body. You are literally changing your form with the words and the emotions you visit upon yourself. This is just a big picture of some of the techniques and tools that we use to help our brothers and sisters deal with racism. And the most important, the critical aspect is healing our identities. Ultimately, as our ancestors knew in Kemet, in Ethiopia prior to Kemet, as well as across the history of Africa and contemporarily, that we are divine beings, not just spiritual beings, but divine beings having a human experience, and we are here to manifest our unique and particular beauty and aspect of being the divine. So I know that's a big jump from thinking you're less than human. So what I share with my clients is that you start where you are and you start working on changing your identity from being less than, from being vulnerable to and susceptible to these assaults. And you empower yourself. This is what I did. Especially when I began to experience these more severe episodes of racism during my medical school years and my residency and into my years of practicing, where I began to say, nope, this is unacceptable. I began to not only say it was not unacceptable, but I began to see myself not only as a survivor, but as the thriver, the overcomer of these experiences. That was the first step. And ultimately, due to my experiences, one in particular that I won't bore you all with the details, but in the midst of a very severe experience of racism, my divinity spoke to me and said, no, this is not the truth. And you have the ability to rise above this if you allow your divinity to speak through you and to act on your behalf. And it changed everything for me. And instead of feeling weak and under attack, I felt empowered by the strength of not only my spirit, but the strength of my ancestors. I knew the truth once and for all in the context of the crisis that has suddenly become the opportunity for me. And I know that it's possible for all of us because this is how we are designed. And yes, there are other powerful techniques to stop these negative thoughts, to replace them. Sometimes I share, when you can't do anything, find ways to laugh, because laughter is a physiological healing mechanism. It makes a difference. yes, we need to address it head on, but sometimes it's too much. Just find ways to left. Turn on YouTube and find one of those stupid videos, and it makes a difference. It will stop it. And there are other techniques, meditation and visualization. Meditation gives our spirit space to inhabit our mind and to express to us in very powerful physiological ways. Freeze frame techniques specifically speak to a heart-based technology that was developed by the researchers in the United States that has profound impact on stress. Affirmation and positive psychology, also spiritual development, finding ways to be grateful. Another one I left off is being in awe. I mentioned I was in awe of the human body. Latest researchers found that simply being in awe takes us to a profound physiological state that's very healing. Next slide, please.
Can I just come in 1 second, sister?
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Yes, sister, because you mentioned, I don't know, because as I said, I've not seen your presentation yet, but would you say that one of the most fundamental elements of dealing, combating racism is having a thorough knowledge of self?
Yes. Yes, that speaks to the identity healing. Absolutely. That's an aspect of it. Learning our history, learning the truth, evacuating and evading those lies of that we didn't have a civilization, that we were less than, that we were primitive and all those lies. Yes, absolutely.
Because I know that once I started to study, it was my brother that first gave me a book that guided me to my own history, my culture, my identity.
Yes.
And I would just say, sister, that fundamentally changed everything about me, my outlook, my perception of self, even academic results. I went back to college with a new, fresh identity of who I was. And straight away, my marks went shooting through the roof. And, and my prospects, my future aspirations changed as well. And so I can't overemphasize the importance of the knowledge of self, which is more than knowing about pyramids and kings and queens. It's a true knowledge of self, you said, from a divine point of view.
Yes, I absolutely agree with you. And that was a part of my journey as well. When I was in college, one of my professors, I took an independent study on African-American literature. And although I knew I was Black before and I had some exposure, it grounded me in the beauty of our literature. And it made me want to explore and to know more. So it led me into studying our history. I did that throughout medical school and my residency. Or you just made me think of my dad. He came to see me one time when I was a resident, and he told me, "You have too many books."
Oh, I was wow. Reading.
Yeah, he said, "You have too many books in your apartment." Because I love to read. And my mother said to him, bless her, she said, "Well, if that's all you have to complain about, consider yourself lucky."
That's a good complaint.
So yes, absolutely. Discovering the truth of our history is critical. Yes.
Sister Jurita. She's still there. You came on a few seconds ago. Was there anything you wanted to say? As you're chomping away.
It's okay. I do that too when I'm off camera.
I decided at that moment to put something in my mouth, and that's when you stopped me. But no. There was a question, but actually the question was answered when you were talking, but there is another one outstanding. It's from Missy G, who says, "Did you say that our spirit and body are one? Could you please elaborate on that, please?"
Yes, I did. Well, I don't have a lot of time today, but I will from the beginning in terms of what I know to be true of African civilization and African history. Our ancestors have known that we are divine beings having a human experience, and that our mind and our body were created for us to inhabit the physical realm. They did not have any determination of separation. And when they spoke of our being, they recognize all those elements as aspects of being. And they had a very detailed description of our spiritual aspect, of our divine aspect, our mental aspect, our psychological, and our physical. It wasn't just body, mind, and spirit. They had 7 levels of the, excuse me, 11 spiritual faculties, 7 levels of being, I mean, of spirit. It was quite detailed in terms of their perception. As I mentioned earlier, Western medicine, Western science in particular, scientists cut a deal with the Catholic Church. As Jung said, the separation between body and mind is artificial. It's made up, just as the whole notion of races are made up. So in the 1500s, Descartes, who said, I think, therefore I am, which is a whole nother issue that I disagree with, I am, therefore I think, that came first. But the long and the short of it is, the Catholic Church, who was, you know, the main political force of the time, wanted to maintain their domain of spiritual control or psychological control. So they struck a deal with the scientists who wanted to dissect bodies, examine the internal organs. So they said, well, you get the body. Do not explore anything about the spirit or the mind. And that was the agreement. And that's why we've had these two different schools of thought and being in the Western realm. It was made up. So, and I will add this, that the spirit, in terms of it being one, the spirit is the source of life. The spirit is the source of the vitality. That's why when the spirit leaves, the body's dead. It is so there's no separation until the spirit leaves. It functions as one unit, one totality of being. That's how it was designed. It wasn't designed to function as a body, a mind, and a spirit. That's not what the divine intended. That's what Western thought and the Western paradigm imposed upon us.
Powerful, sister. Absolutely powerful.
I'm not too sure. I don't want to cut you if you're in this, the middle of your presentation still. But
no, I think I'm at the end, actually.
Okay.
And I quickly ask a question. I'm sorry to interrupt. Dr. Elaine, this is mind-blowing, but you mentioned of identity healing, and it's that just added to the eureka. I was like, oh, that's exactly how much power do you feel that will give us to, as we always say, get to that top of that mountain, to the liberation? Because as soon as you said that, that lines up with, as I said before, knowing your story, your experience is so critical. So I'd give thanks, but I just wanted to know, where do you think that could take us once we really do that identity healing? Really, thank you.
Beautiful, Nat.
It takes us to the truth. It takes us to our power. It takes us to our capacity to overcome anything. I mean, we have to remember, when I began to put my life in context, not only in terms of my identity, but in terms of my ancestors, what they went through for me to be here, it changes everything because, and let me explain this. Our beliefs, our thoughts, our emotions shape our physiology. As that diagram of the two crystals, the crystal and the ugly water. So when you think differently, you change your physiology. And when you begin to think of yourself in terms of the truth, you come in alignment with your spirit and with the truth of who you are, which allows you to function at a higher level. And it also protects us. I mean, we literally have a spiritual immune system. When we express, when we align with the truth, when we identify ourselves differently, we literally create a shield that protects us. Because our reaction to racism, understandably, has been a knee-jerk distress response because we feel victimized. And we are on the physical level. I am not disputing that. But I'm saying we have a choice to respond differently. And just making that choice changes things because you become aware. Normally what happens to us, especially in the workplace or when we see things on TV, the first thing I tell people is quit watching television. It is traumatic. We're getting constantly triggered by these images, like the baby who was being drugged. I mean, I was traumatized again, but I could recover because I knew the truth. but we're constantly deluged with these images that's making us sick. We've never been exposed to so many images of Black death as we have in the last, been in the last really 8 to 10 years, I think. But now it's this constant barrage of here's the next one, here's the next one, and that's harming us. So we have to de-traumatize ourselves. We have to stop and shield ourselves from that. Yes, you can know, but there's different ways to know. You don't have to always be on the internet or on the news watching it because it traumatizes us. So that's one aspect of it. But when we begin, let me just put it like this. When you are functioning and thinking from the truth, from your spiritual reality, you're shielded from the harm, from those assaults from the, in a very different way. It's not a conscious response. It's how the spirit protects us because it shields us with the truth. You know the truth. I know who I am. And you your perception of yourself has caused a physiological state that's healthier and that's healing. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. Absolutely, sister. Sister Jurita.
Yeah, definitely makes sense. Sister, you've been blowing up the chat.
I knew this would happen. I knew this would happen.
Literally already asked if you can come back 3, 4, 5 times, not even just once. So they are richly, showing their for everything that you've done today. So thank you so much for that. One person in particular, Boss, I'm going to bring you up again just because you called me out on not reading out your question. But he said that he could feel your cordial energy power. And that's what he said in there. He said, you're smashing it, Queen. But his question outside of that was, how significant is the midbrain to one's spiritual development?
Well, let me answer in this way. As I mentioned during the presentation with that diagram of the midbrain where the amygdala is and where those stress responses is, I tend not to think of brain structures in terms of spiritual development because it's not in the brain. The brain reflects the spiritual development. The development occurs on an electromagnetic level, if you will, or an invisible thought and emotional level that you can't see in the brain. See, the brain, again, in Western thought, the brain was it was just like DNA. It's the be all and end all and do all, and it's the controller. Well, that was the imposition of Western dissociated thought onto the physical form. The truth of the matter is that the brain is not the organ in the body that sets the tone of the body. It's the heart. And I briefly mentioned HeartMath, the company, and their research. What this research, these particular researchers back in the 1990s found that our heartbeat entrains the brain. So when the heart is beating normally, the brain functions normally. But when the heart beats erratically, the brain functions erratically. That's part of the distress response. So the heart is the electromagnetic organ that centers everything in terms of our, it guides everything, not the brain. The brain is really the relay station. It's not the origin. It just keeps everything in order more than anything else. But it's our heart, which is where I believe the soul is anchored. It's the heart that sets the pace. So when those techniques that I mentioned, the freeze frame, it helps you focus on the heart and changing your breathing to get the heart back into its normal rhythm. And when you have a strong normal rhythm based on your emotional state, then you can endure anything. But when you respond with those stress responses and your heart is, all over the place, that's when we weaken ourselves and enable those distress responses to create the unhealthy environments that lead to our disease. That's why we die younger. Let me put it specifically in ways you understand the significance. We are dying younger, not because of the racist experiences, but because of how we respond to them. And that's our power. We have the power to choose differently. We have the power to respond differently. How else did our ancestors survive what they did? How did they come out of the bowels of the slave ships, the enslavement ships, after being imprisoned for months on the coast of West Africa? How did they arrive on these shores with any semblance of sanity? And one of my friends, I'll tell this story because this is, it's such a beautiful story. And she's the one that makes me think of these. But my roommate from college decided in the 80s to go to Ghana and to take the Black Star back. She wanted to retrace the steps, the voyage of her ancestors. So she and her friend, a female friend, paid for a cabin on a Black Star line and left the coast of Ghana. And she said they spent a few days on the Côte d'Ivoire. And when they went into the Atlantic, a storm came up. So they were stuck in their cabins for several days. And she said, when the storm was over, they went out on the deck. And the first thought that came to her was, how did my ancestors survive a storm like this in the bowels of a slave ship? How did they? And she said, and this is what really I honor her for. Her name is Candace Francis. Candace said to me, Elaine, not only how did they survive in the bowels of the slave ship, but how did they arrive on the shores of the New World and reproduce? How did they do that? And that is really the question. It was their spiritual strength that allowed them to live for us. They could have easily gone into mass psychosis, easily. It's understandable, but they did not. They had a strength that we have within us. We have the inheritance of this strength of indomitability that we don't even call on. We don't even think about it because we are so used to surviving, that we're so caught up in the survival part that we don't remember the miracle of the survival just on the level of survival that we have experienced. The fact that for me, and I tell my patients this and my friends and my family, the fact that we can wake up and get up out of the bed in the morning knowing what we have to face in the world is a miracle. And that's the truth. We don't even give ourselves credit for that because that's our normal. We don't even think about it. We are a magnificent, just by virtue of our being, we're magnificent, we're amazing, but we are triumphant. We are the survivors of those who refuse to die, each and every one of you hearing this sound of my voice. And it's time for you to honor yourself and love and appreciate yourself and your ancestors for that truth. That will give you strength. That will give you the ability to look at whatever you're facing and say, not today. You're not, no, you're not. I am the captain of my ship, not you. We give our power away because we think until racism ends, until we got to keep protesting, we got to keep doing this so it'll end so we'll feel better. No, we can be triumphant in these moments as we move towards its end and its transformation and its healing.
Teach.
We don't have, if we wait, we'll be gone. We'll be on that plane. We'll be on the passenger list for those planes and prematurely leaving here. My work is to get rid of those boarding passes, to help you all not board those planes of destruction and death, to know that you are worthy, that you are blessed, and you are worthy of experiencing. You have a gift. You, each and every one of us is a genius in our own way. Each and every one of us has a unique gift of wonder that we are here to share. The earth will not be fulfilled if you don't fulfill your destiny. That's why I do this, because I know the truth. I'm not special. I'm just an early adapter, that's all. Some flowers bloom early, some bloom late, some bloom in the middle. That's the only difference.
Lovely, thank you so much, sister.
My pleasure.
I have one last question just to wrap up. And this one is, it's a bit of an amalgamation of a few that have come through, but mainly it's an adaptation of Sis Lightning's question. And she asks and I guess this is something that all of us need to think about, because we come to this platform each week, we soak up and we absorb everything that we hear, and then we switch off and we kind of go back into similar routines until next Tuesday, until we can hear it again. So a few of the questions that have come through are, what practical steps and what practice changes would you want us to do and take away that we can start to implement daily to change our outlook and to start to heal the way that you have suggested?
Well, this is no easy task. So we're going to have, and Brother Andrew's going to talk about it, we're going to have a vehicle to help everyone begin their healing journey in a meaningful way. In addition to that, what I would say, as I said during the presentation, those five steps, the most important step is to make a firm, intentional decision, irrevocable. Because we know, yes, we come on every week and we're good and we're pumped up, but there's a difference between information and transformation. And what Brother Andrew's platform is really a platform of transformation. But if we're only getting the information and getting refed, then we're not fulfilling the true purpose of the entire purpose of this platform, which is to inspire you to transform. So again, you have to make that decision. Today is a different day. As I said, I made a decision in the midst of a crisis that I'm done with this. And it changed my life because it was from my being, and you all know what I'm talking about. When you make up your mind to do something, you do it, correct? When you really grasp something that you want, you have set, our intentions literally change our physiology to allow us the opportunity to achieve the intention. So when you really set that intention, like, I am not gonna let this harm me anymore. I know I am the master of my being in a way I never knew, then you change it. And you begin to, let me just say it like this, setting the intention and loving yourself are the two most important things.
Woo!
We have to love ourselves. And Woo! We have to love ourselves as we are, not as we want to be and want to change into being. I love myself when I lose those 10 pounds, I love myself. No. You have to love and accept yourself as you are now. And I'm not talking about love from the personality, from your ain't I cute part, or aren't I special, or aren't I macho? No, I'm talking about the love from your divinity that is the source of that love, but it comes unobstructed. And you know what I'm talking about. And we can come to that in meditation when we really get quiet and allow the truth, because the truth is we are love. That's the truth.
We are absolutely love.
Oh, yes. That's why we're still here, because love is the force of the universe. Love is the connecting force. Love is what allowed our ancestors to survive. That's the truth as I know it.
Absolutely. Emphasize that point, sister. Emphasize that point, please. This is key. Yes,
we must love ourselves. Love is acceptance. Love is appreciation. Love is affirmation. Woo! Love is, it's an all-encompassing acceptance of the truth of who we are. And it's unencumbered by exception. It is the purity of the being that we are. That's how we survive. Children, I learned this in college. Monkeys and babies who are given all the physical needs do not survive unless they receive love. We call it failure to thrive. Yes, there were studies that, well, you know, because again, our paradigm in Western science is reductionist, and we're told emotions don't matter, blah, 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 all that crap. I'm sorry, I lost myself for a moment. I'm not being
particular. Lose yourself again. Lose yourself again. Teach.
We are emotional beings. Emotions fuel us, and we are to honor and recognize them. The ultimate state of emotion is peace. That's our primary being, and love and joy and bliss. But our other emotions come to inform us. Every emotion we have has its place. Anger has its place. There's such a thing as righteous indignation. Yeah, you're supposed to get upset when you're being mistreated. That's normal. If you respond it's submissively, that worsens your physiology, because that's the lie. When we feel negative emotions, they come to inform us, like I said, of pain and of our being out of alignment with the truth. When you're in alignment with your truth, what do you feel? Happy, you feel peace, you feel joy. The pain comes when you're out of alignment with it, either from an experience of harm that comes to you or the thoughts that you're experiencing that are not in alignment with the truth. Miss Jarita, I'm feeling that's especially for you, sweetheart.
I
don't know why, but that's how spirit guides me.
That's beautiful, absolutely beautiful. And you know, brothers and sisters, those of you that was at the beginning of the show, I played this little clip, sister, Dr. Elaine, and I think this, I just loved it because of the spirit of our sister. She's actually on the platform today.
Hey, King. Boy, you did it again. Constantly raising the bar for your brother kings and doing it without apology. Wow. Can I reason with you for just a second? You know you're a king, right? You're strong and worthy of the praise. So don't let anyone or anything get in the way of that.
Yes.
I know at times you may feel unworthy, unloved, unappreciated, misunderstood. Trust me, us sister queens, we understand. But I want you to remember how powerful you are.
Yes.
Your flair, your aura, your divine presence is of heights existence. Yeah, Miss Cecil. Heights existence. So the next time you want to think anything different, don't. You have to remember you are 100% that king. I am Messiah.
Yes.
At Sister M Queen, and I approve this message.
Yes,
that's, I mean, just say, you know, you've got to keep feeding that love, that knowledge of that divinity.
Yes, one of my professors, I took a class, and it took me about 4 decades to understand what he said. Well, I took a class on African literature, African American literature, and Dr. Professor Michael Harper, who was a well-known poet, and he had us reading a book by Jean Toomer of the Harlem Renaissance called Cain. It was about enslavement. And he said something, I never forgotten it. As I said, it took me decades to understand. But he said that this novel about slavery was not about human rights violations. It was about the cosmic violation that slavery is. Now, as I said, it took me a long time to understand that. He's absolutely correct. As I mentioned, the notion of separating us from our true spiritual connectivity to the divine was the real intention of religious imposition. Because when you separate a person violently and traumatically from their spiritual core and the truth, they can be manipulated. They can become whoever you tell them they are because they are not connected consciously. We're still connected, obviously, and in the bigger sense of the picture, but they are not consciously connected to the truth of their being, and they are subjected to accepting the lies imposed on them. That's what I know to be true.
Powerful. Sister, we nearly touched 500 today listening to you, but my last question, and I thank you, Sister Jarita, thank you, Bob. My last question, and Bob says, I want us just to, and there's a reason why I'm gonna share this for just a few seconds, because you're a very powerful sister. You're very ladylike, you're eloquent, but you're a militant sister. So I wanted to know, and I'm sure Bob says, wanted to know, how do you combine all of what you are with your militant outlook, which is unapologetically spiritually and black? How do you then speak here?
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Elaine Ferguson.
you. Chronic diseases, heart disease, cancer, diabetes, Alzheimer's, obesity, depression, anxiety, and others are rapidly increasing, affecting millions of Americans. And we're getting sicker, younger, and faster. Believe it or not.
You want me to answer that?
80% of all cases.
That was the question, sister. I mean, you see how you're uncompromising, but yet you're on national television and you got Europeans looking at you as a goddess. You're like your God speaking to them. How do you combine that reality?
I don't find it to be a conflict because I know the truth. We are all divine beings. And behavior is one thing, reality is another. And I honor what I'm guided to do. So I don't see I believe, and I'm glad you asked that question, because I've never been asked that question publicly before. I believe the reason we see, and understandably, the question that you asked us as a valid one is because our pain, our trauma, tends to make us want to stay away, understandably. But that's not always the case, and that's not always the possibility. So I have, my growth has been to do what I'm guided to do, whatever that may be. And I don't tolerate racism in my life. And I've lost friends. I mean, I've lost close friends who during this last year who just could not deal with the reckoning and how they were triggered. So I'm just very honest. I am always who I am. I don't compromise my being because I'll get in trouble and I don't want to do that. So I'm just honest. And honestly, I will tell you, and let me be very honest with you. When I went into practice, and especially during my early years and during my residency, I got much more respect from European American patients than I did from African American patients. I did. I mean, I would, I was so hurt because when I was in medical school, I said, well, when I get through this, I'm gonna have Black patients who really appreciate me. That took many years, and some did during my residency, but the vast majority of my patients did not. They wanted Caucasian doctors. So that's the dichotomy, that's the contradiction in which we live. But the bottom line is that for me, let me just put it to you like this. I read a book years ago, and it helped me to understand how to love people who were, because I'm not loving in terms of my personality, I'm loving from spirit. Yes, we can love people who have harmed us from a great distance, because that's the truth of who we are, and they are a part of the divine creation, regardless, despite their behavior. So you love people from a distance. You don't, just because you love does not mean you are subjecting yourself to becoming a victim or to being abused. That's not what love is. Love is the strength that says no. Love is, you love yourself enough to honor yourself. So that's why I don't see the contradictions, because I treat people the way I want to be treated. That's how I was raised. And also I grew up in a very integrated community, which was highly unusual. I grew up with children from around the world. I didn't know what a foreigner was. And that's how my parents raised me. Even before I was exposed to my neighborhood, my parents taught me we're all God's children, and that's how they lived. So that's, I think, the difference. And yes, I have had my time and my pain and my suffering in the course of my life that have led me to want to react differently. That's a part of my growth. That's a part of our growth. But the bottom line for me is that love does not mean you get abused. No, that's the opposite. Love is the strength to say no to your abuser. Yes, you love yourself enough to remove yourself from being abused.
That is powerful. That is powerful, sister. That is powerful. Yes. Oh, beloved brothers and sisters, this is Dr. Elaine Ferguson, MD, Chicago, nationwide. Come on, man, show some love, man. If you felt the sister Santa Banani, you show it. Tell the sister, I see you. Only if you felt it. Put down some ones on that chat room. Only if you mean it. If you walked to that sister today, tell the sister yourself, please. And remember, this is the first time this has been on the platform. We are hoping and we're discussing about doing some work together. The sister's going to be dealing with some, we're going to be putting together some, was it super healing circles? And she's going to spend time, especially for us in the UK, because of the time difference. We're going to put something together whereby we can go through this healing process together. And the sister's going to be working with us on this. And for those of you that want to sign up, we've got a program waiting for you, brothers and sisters. We've got to start the healing process immediately. It's a new day and a new time. Sister, can you remind me? Because I love the term you gave, the umbrella theme of the workshop, sister. Emancipate yourself. Sister Elaine. Oh, is she on? Oh, is it frozen? Oh, damn. Oh, is it frozen? Because, oh, it's frozen. Yeah, it's right, true. Brothers and sisters, for those of you that are on my mail out list, tomorrow I will start mailing out the details for Dr. Elaine in terms of signing up for this joint process that we're going to be putting together. She's going to be doing the workshops, and it's going to be emancipate yourself, okay, from the mental slavery that's been happening to us. Oh, sister, you're back with us. Could you just quickly, sister, in a few seconds, just touch on the what we spoke about earlier, the healing circle and emancipating yourself?
Yes, thank you. Well, the emancipate yourself from mental slavery is really a continuation and an expansion of what I've shared with you today. And it goes into the specific steps in greater detail with more information about how to begin shifting your mindset, how to begin incorporating these healing techniques into your daily regimen. That's the Emancipate Your Health from Mental Slavery online webinar that I'm hoping we'll do with during UK time, because we, you know, I'm 6 hours behind you. And we also have a full set of series of programs for healing racism for our brothers and sisters around the world. And the first step is, and after the Emancipate Your Health webinar, is a series of healing circles where we tackle and take on these topics: what's happened in the last year, racism in health, workplace discrimination, the lie of so-called white privilege, during an eight-part series of live healing circles where we come together in a very sacred space to be honest with each other and to share and to support each other. So that's what we're looking forward to creating on your side of the pond for your time zone sometime in the fall, I believe we talked about.
So brothers and sisters, remember this. Sister is putting something together, especially for us in the UK. So this is going to be amazing. Details will be coming out soon. Sister Jurita, is there anything you'd like to say before we finish our show? And I mean, we still got over 400 plus people on the platform.
I want to say something. I want to say something to Jurita, and it just hit me. Why I... You look like my cousin. You look, oh my goodness, that's why I have to, that's why I felt so called to you. Look like one of my cousins.
Oh, wow.
Well, she might be
cute. When you smiled, you could be her sister.
She's clearly quite cute then.
Very.
The only thing I was going to say is I've got first dibs on this, on the workshop. I'm definitely going to attend. I think everybody, if you've got time, do it. All of us are struggling with our own, you know, little hurdles, our own speed bumps, whatever that might be, but we just need a way to figure out how to do best for ourselves. So yeah, I'm there. Thank you so
wonderful.
Much.
Wonderful. And one of the things I know about group healing, I learned this teaching meditation. When groups come together for the purpose of healing, it uplifts and potentiates each individual's healing capacity. It's really quite magical what happens. I got my husband to meditate with me yesterday. I said, oh gosh, I went into my deep state much faster, and I've been meditating for 10, 15 years regularly. It happens much faster when groups come together
I definitely think you share energy with others, and if you are
it makes a difference.
It also sort of enlightens you to things that you might not have even thought about yourself, but when somebody else says it, you go, oh yeah, that happens to me as well, and you kind of understand a lot more. So yeah, definitely agreed.
Brothers and sisters, remember, this has been the Hidden Truth Show. Remember our beautiful queen we had here today, Dr. Elaine Ferguson, the truth about racism. She went and dissected it and brought it back together again. And what I'm leaving with is self-healing and self-love, brothers and sisters. Let us start that on a serious level today. We can do it together. We don't have to do it individually. We can come together, accept ourselves, heal ourselves with the knowledge of self and with self-love. I don't think there's any more thing powerful in the universe than love. Love, brothers and sisters. And that love starts with yourself. And when you realize how powerful you are, and how in awe was our sister's words, how in awe you are of your creation, then you start appreciating the creation that's around you too. Sister Elaine will be coming back very soon. We'll be working. We want to give a big shout out to Brother Na-ra. Come on, brothers and sisters, because see, God plans over this, brothers and sisters, because the sisters break down about self-healing and self-love and self-acceptance. Our brother was on his journey dealing with generational stories, which is exactly the same thesis that the sister was breaking down. We've got to know our stories, brothers and sisters, and the stories of our grandparents and our nation. We also want to thank our big brother, Leon Marshall,